back to the whole purpose of the Open Meetings and Open Records Act. Remember what I said the purpose was? It's to foster transparency and confidence in government. And I think the Zoning Procedures Act is another similar of those sorts of enactments. And I think that the way you foster transparency and confidence in government is to have open meetings, have published agendas, have published calls of meetings, have open and candid debate in front of the public, and also if there's a disqualifying or conflicting event that disqualifies you from your ability to serve, you need to put your fellow members of your commission and the public on sufficient notice that they can assess accurately what is going on and why this individual can't vote. That's it.
Have you got the stuff with you that we fill out so that we can?
I don't have it with me. But I'm going to talk to Tom about it and give you some guidance as to how I'll
fill those forms out.
I'm going to take care of it with Tom, and we've talked about that previously. Okay. If you do that, and if you disqualify yourself, you're out. I don't mean sort of out. I don't mean you're out only in the public meetings. I mean you're out. And that means you cannot participate, cannot lobby behind the scenes, cannot make phone calls, cannot write emails. You're out. And that's a big deal to me, because there is a case where action was overturned because even though the commission member did disqualify themselves, they continued to lobby behind the scenes. That comes out in discovery, as it always does. And you can't do that. If you're disqualified, you're disqualified.
Can you still sit in the meeting, or do you have to leave?
You can still sit in the meetings. The rule is, if it is at a public meeting, you have the right to sit there.
And we've always gone out. We actually leave the room. Yeah.
That's fine, too. Unless if you want to leave, that's fine. But I'm comfortable with, if you want to sit there.
You just can't make faces at people.
You can't make faces. Well, and you know. You definitely can't.
Well, disapproval.
You can't make. Here's what I like to see happen. I like to see the disqualification made at the earliest opportunity, and then the evening of the vote, everybody will have long forgotten that, except you. I mean, the person who actually disqualified, you remember, right? Everybody else will forget, just for purposes of, again, instilling citizen confidence and transparency. Just announce this matter, pursuant to my previous notice provided at this meeting, I just want to remind the gallery and my fellow board members that I did disqualify and recuse. I've engaged in no lobbying activity, and I will not vote on this matter. No big deal. Okay.
What happens if that's not, if somebody makes an issue out of that?
Makes an issue out of what?
If you didn't recuse yourself when you should have, what happens?
Well, it depends how they make the issue out of it. Okay, there's a couple of different tracks. One is the track we've kind of forecast, and that is the zoning procedures challenge. If there was supposed to be a disqualification, and there wasn't, and a lawsuit is filed saying or suggesting that a vote was taken with an individual casting a vote that should have disqualified themselves under the Act, if that is in fact found to be true, then the zoning, the official action, will be overturned.
Can you go to jail?
Well, I believe that there has been a situation in a nearby county. I believe there was a situation in a nearby county where a Board of Commission member was found to have not identified a colony. Does everybody know what I'm talking about? I'm not trying to take it. Okay. I'll talk to you about it offline. But there was a commission member or individual that did not disclose, and I believe that was cited or accused as a misdemeanor. And that's been in the last 6 months.
Now, what does that mean exactly?
That means that they're facing a potential minimum, if they are found guilty of it, of 364 days in jail.
Okay.
Now, that's the exception. As far as a criminal prosecution, the typical result is an overturning of the zoning action. I think that was a product, quite frankly, of the grand jury having a long time to consider this individual. If everybody knows the facts of that, and if they don't, I'll tell you all about them. But the typical product of that, and there's plenty of cases where we could talk about the specific cases where the result has been an overturning of the zoning decision and no one's gone to jail. Now, the other thing that could occur, of course, is a complaint under the ethics ordinance. The ethics ordinance also speaks in terms of conflicted official action. And so even if it's not a zoning decision being overturned, it could still be an ethics complaint filed against a commissioner or a planning commissioner.
And what happens then?
The ethics ordinance provides various sorts of punishment that could occur, everything from censure to a request for the review by the district attorney. Mm-hmm. You know, quite frankly, I mean, the ethics ordinance is a vehicle, you know, it has a lot of different reasons, but the main product is to get these matters out in the open and allow a complaint to be made and allow a response to be provided and then to authorize a hearing in certain circumstances. Okay, so a full open hearing on the facts. So, you know, conflicts of interest are a big deal. They can expose the commission, the board of commissioners, the county, to a liability. They can result in litigation. So just be mindful of this. And I will tell you, and I will kind of end the way I started, and that is, we don't want, in this county, we don't want to be buttoned up to the line of our legal or ethical obligations. We owe it, I believe, to our citizens and our constituents to have full transparency and to have full accountability and to stay well clear of the line. So I'm sort of giving you what the line is. A lot of times, folks, particularly with respect to your decision to recuse, you may not have a direct financial interest. You may not be an undisclosed partner in X LLC. Forget about that. At some point, too, you need to assess yourself and say, can I act upon this official business, which is before me, in an impartial, detached, neutral, and objective manner? And if the answer to that is, I can't, even if it's not a financial interest, maybe it's some other sort of interest. Maybe you hate the person in front of you. I'm saying, maybe you do. Then, if that's the case, that too could affect your impartiality and you need to recuse. Everybody understand what I'm saying? The law says if you've got a pecuniary or financial interest, you're out of there. I'm telling you, ethically, if your objectivity is imperiled or somehow implicated by something that's going on privately with you, you might want to recuse even in that situation.
When I went to the training session back in November, that was one of the big things that the lady there kept bringing up. I mean, 100 times, has this got to pass the smell test? Doesn't matter whether it's ethical or legal, but if it smells funny, don't even get close to it.
Well, I mean, that's rule one.
That's what you said about the bright line.
And that's the bright line. And, you know, there is that line. And again, you know, a direct financial interest is the line. You cross over that line, bad stuff can happen. But I'm telling you, and the advice I give to everybody I try to speak to on these issues is stay well clear of the line. That's the better one.